Hey, I'm Victor Margiotta, and this is the Community Show. My guest tonight is Dan Dennehy. We are going to talk about Ireland. Right now, it's one of the greatest places to live in the world. They're international. They are not only focused on education and supporting other countries, but they are doing everything they can to keep things green. Leave it to the Emerald Island to keep things green. But I just want to say what a great day I had yesterday with family, how blessed I am that my niece had a little baby, and now she's got three little boys. So congratulations, Gina and Ian, on their little family that they're building. And what a great time it is to be alive. I really got to say that this is the greatest moment of my life, only because this is the only moment I have. The past is gone. The future is uncertain. So we have to live for today. So, Dan, thank you so much for coming on.
Well, thanks, and congratulations, Grandpa. It's tremendous.
Well, Uncle Vic, my brother John's daughter.
I see.
And my brother Gerard's daughter had a baby. That's her first. Mm. And, you know, we're growing in leaps and bounds, and it's just so beautiful.
I know we have an au pair who came to help us with our children when they were little, because Siobhan and I work. And now she lives here. She came from Germany, and she married a nice Italian-American guy from the area. And they have two children. Now we're babysitting. So, full circle.
Yeah.
You know? So thanks for having me on, Vic. It's great to be here.
I love talking about tradition. I love talking about family. And what are some of the things that you taught your daughters about family and tradition?
Well, the same way I learned. I mean, it was great to be able to hear people relate their stories of growing up in your family, so you want to hear that. And also, the family just didn't sit around the fire talking. I mean, we were usually out socializing, and socialization for my family involved a lot with family, but as well with organizations. So my father was involved with a fraternity that started here in 1836, from the Irish immigrants sticking up for their faith and their heritage. It was called the Ancient Order of Hibernians, and he was very active in that. My mother was an Irish immigrant from County Leitrim, and she loved her Irish heritage. I mean, we weren't a family that was really just home a lot. We were visiting family, or we were out doing stuff within, going up to the Catskills, or traveling around the country, and we wanted to do the same thing with our daughters. My wife came here from Ireland, and basically it's funny how history repeats itself, but our two daughters are now growing into lovely ladies, going to college, and we hope that the stuff that we instilled in them is something that will make them social creatures themselves, and I'm very confident they will. Yeah.
Yeah, and giving back to the community, which is something that you enjoy. So let's talk about that.
I think the girls definitely picked up on that. Several years ago, Hurricane Sandy struck the shoreline, and, we were kind of affected by it up here, but nothing like the people on the shoreline communities.
Yeah.
And one of my favorite pictures is Ashley and Kara wearing face masks and gloves, and helping break down there was a little Protestant denomination church that Habitat Humanity was going to use for a headquarters. So we had to strip all the insulation down. So there was Benny Keeney and his wife Nora and my two little daughters, probably stuff that you don't normally rush your kids into doing, stripping insulation off a wall. But they were wearing respirators and goggles. So they learned at a young age, and the festival. Kara is our ambassador for the junior volunteers, and Ashling and herself trained all the kids how to, greet the people coming to the festival, and they've always looked for community service hours as kind of like we would look for high scores on a pinball machine, and I think that that's a testament to maybe not only encouraging them to participate, but making it interesting.
This year would have been the 12th year for the Irish Festival?
Yeah, the 12th. I mean, the tradition of Irish Festa, as the Italians would say, in Peekskill goes way, way back. I've met many generations of leaders that have done the festas, the festivals, the feasts. And it's nice that these traditions carry on. Recently, I was interviewed for a Belfast, Ireland talk, and they said, why do you keep doing it? And I said, we do it because this is what gathers the people together. I mean, we want to see each other. We want to work together. And you roll up your sleeves on a fest, and people come in, and they enjoy themselves. Well, you know, you run a restaurant here with your family, you know, the greatest satisfaction you have is seeing people sitting around and enjoying each other and the meal that you've prepared for them. So. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's true. Yeah. You know, my father was a member of the Italian Club. He was a member of the local fire department, the Verpine Fire Department. Mm-hmm. You know, he couldn't get as involved as he would have liked to because he's here a lot. Mm-hmm. And, you know, to run a restaurant is a lot of work. For me, the same. You know, I worked 6 days a week. Mm-hmm. My day off, I enjoyed playing golf, which I still do.
Good stuff.
And, you know, but now I'm getting older. I'm not married. I don't have kids. So that actually makes me an expert on marriage and raising kids.
Yes. I think we could take some good advice on the do's and don'ts of that. Yeah.
So, but I am very involved in the church. Mm-hmm. And I recently starting to think about joining the Rotary. I've been going to the meetings, which was nice. This, you know, these Zoom meetings are something else. You can go and actually still do what you're doing. Mm. But what Zoom meetings have you been on?
Oh, God. Well, first of all, the purpose of all of these organizations is to get together and network. Yeah. And I don't know if that word existed 100 years ago, but we certainly see that they were doing that. Mm-hmm. We see the accomplishments. The photos around this restaurant show, parades and celebrations for many, many years, and some of them even have some Hibernians in them, because this area that we're in is some of the oldest parts of our organization. Mm-hmm. You know, all of a sudden, it's not safe to meet socially. So this thing, Zoom, in the beginning people were very afraid of it because they heard it might have foreign influence in it. But you know what? Now organizations it's become so commonplace. Our national president said we went from the 19th century to the 22nd century in
overnight,
no time.
Right?
Overnight. Because there's an ease to it. And also there's some politeness involved with it too. I mean, if everybody talks at the same time, it's a cacophony, nothing gets accomplished. There's order in we're the ancient order of Hibernians, there's order there. And it was nice to see that order transfer to a remote communication. Our kids are doing school remotely. My wife's entire job of service in the Emerald Isle Immigration Center involves helping the most recent New Yorkers is the way I put it, because every word these days is almost a double entendre, you know. But the newest New Yorkers, the immigrant community, whatever they're from, it was started to help the Irish, but it helps the whole New York City and definitely a lot of Irish people. But they can't meet. So they have to do all their advice online. They have to do all their advice by a video. So thank God for this technology, and thank God for the introduction of broadband, because if we were going by the old dial-up, forget about it.
For sure.
Yeah.
No, I actually enjoy the meetings. They are good. And it's nice that everybody mutes, because a lot of times there'll be background noise, and then their picture comes up, and the boom, boom, boom. Yeah. So it's... Yeah. But then, like you said, just having the respect for everybody, and everybody gets their turn, which is nice.
Yeah, and in some cases, you're hearing from people that you wouldn't hear from, that would sit at the back of the room and never say a word. Well, now everybody's face is the same size. You know what I mean? Like it or not.
I mean, there's nothing like personal contact and getting together. There's no doubt about that. And hopefully soon we will get back to that. And I like that you said moving forward. So moving forward, what are you going to do for the Irish Fest this year as far as?
Well, today, actually, our chairman, Cahill McGrail, a lot of people in this community are very familiar with Chuck.
Hey, Chuck.
Chuck is the owner of the lately lamented Quiet Man Public House in Peekskill. through no fault of his own, that establishment had to close. And Chuck also had for many, many, many years and continues to have the thriving Hibernian millwork business. But more important to that, Chuck is a keystone of this community.
Yeah.
He came here from Ireland. He lived in other parts. He adopted this region. And now he's stepped into the role as the chairman of the festival, which I welcome, because we have a great committee. We have male and female board members, and young and old, so we're using from all aspects of our community. Some people have business technique skills. Other people are good in communication, and really everybody brings something to the table, but nobody gets paid. So it's a thankless job in one regard. Having a festival would involve going through strictures that we've never had the experience before, and we felt that we're not there that yet. So like many other giant festivals, I mean, the Milwaukee Festival has millions of visitors. Our little teeny festival in Peekskill has thousands of visitors. But you know, we're gonna do some stuff virtually. We haven't really come up with the format of it yet, because we were kind of hoping that we could do something small. But one thing I will say is this: we have punched above our weight the entire existence of the festival. We provide family fun from the entrance all the way through the festival. Yeah, we have a beer garden, and it's a beautiful spot on the river, but it's done respectfully. The people stay in there when they're drinking the beverages. They're not walking through the park. Right? That way, the children's area, which is directly across from there, they're doing 18th century toys and crafts. There's nobody looking at their phones. They're playing with toys and making crafts that people made in the days before radio, before telegram. And we have a spoken word tent. So we're not blowing people up with music at the main stage. It's loud enough that the people in the beer tent can enjoy it, but not loud enough that the people in the spoken word tent or the trad tent get drowned out. The trad tent is some of the greatest musicians in the country coming together basically for the love of the music and the love of being heard and playing together. And the spoken word tent, you have writers, authors, and people with ideas that are concept people thinking about what, you know, maybe making a film or a historical endeavor of some kind. And we have some great artifacts that come from this area and Ireland and American military history. It's tremendous. Yeah. So, you know, we can't do that all, but we're going to try and squeeze it into that little lens as best we can, so that you at home can still feel like this thing, this Irish Center, is still yours. It's still ours, and it's going to be a collaborative effort. So watch this space, you know, www.hudsonvalleyirishfest.com or on Facebook, you know, at the Hudson Valley Irish Fest and Center. We will get through this. Just unfortunately, it's going to be like the 11th and a 5th festival instead of the 12th. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly. So. Now the same happened with the parade also.
Yeah, we got this close.
Yeah, were we going to do it in October or?
You know, the problem again is you want your honorees to be honored. Myself and Siobhan, my wife, were suitably honored in 2019.
Congratulations.
We were co-grand marshals. The only other time that ever happened before was with Joe and Ann Brady, where you had two grand marshals. And it was a wonderful day. It was a tremendous day. To truncate that for a guy like John Testa, who's our you know, great educator and legislator and promoter of everyone's culture as the mayor, he had to support everybody's culture, and John definitely adopted the Irish culture. So for him to, he's a worthy grand marshal and he deserves his day up the avenue.
Yeah.
So I don't know if truncating that is worth it either. But you know what, that's at the discretion of a committee that I'm very proud to have been affiliated with for many years, the Peekskill St. Patrick's Day Parade Committee. They've been at it for 31 years this year, because I think we were the 30th anniversary. And we marched in the first one, Siobhan and I.
Wow.
So we were seven when we did that. But, you know, it will rise again. And when the call is pulled off of this world and it's healed, I mean, I think the environment's been healed a lot because there's not as many things.
It's amazing, really, how just in a few months, the amount of, you know, fuel that has been, you know, and it's, there's so many things that we could learn from this. You know, when it is flu season, maybe we should wear masks and gloves, you know. You know, maybe we should wash our hands on a daily basis. But, you know, and, you know, maybe we shouldn't just drive our cars around, you know, maybe go for a walk.
Other people. Yeah, at least protect other people. Think about somebody else. You know, you say it, you wear the mask, you're really not protecting yourself from other people, but you're protecting other people from yourself. And you're right. And, you know, this year we've spent a lot of time in nature. Haven't we had to walk everywhere? You know, you're home, you're working at home, you got to get out of the house. Yeah. And we just happen to live in one of the prettiest places on the planet.
Yeah.
You know, the Hudson Valley, you know, and we've learned to appreciate our favorite restaurants. We've learned to lament some of our favorite people that have passed away, and not to be able to mourn them in the traditional way. But I think we're going to have, our taste buds are going to be better. Hopefully we'll be a little fitter. I see that you're doing pretty well.
I've always exercised, and this it really gave me an opportunity. You know, I have my own equipment, so I'm able to do it at home. And, you know, I've always enjoyed going to gym. I do like the social aspect, and it's funny because I'll be at the gym, and I was in a sport every season in high school, so the first thing you do before you work out is stretch out. And I'd stretch out, and it's funny, after a month of being in the gym, you'd see everybody start to stretch out. Because they know they're supposed to be doing it, but it's like something you skip.
Yeah.
So.
Well, our secret pleasure is some of myself and my friends from the Hibernians, Ray Birmingham, and my friend who lives in this community here, Aiden O'Kelly Lynch, we've been sneaking out and playing golf.
Awesome.
And golf was something I did with my father. It's something I played for Mount St. Michael, a high school team. It devolved into something that I only did at golf outings, and I really missed golf and the banter, as we Irish say, of walking a course or even hopping in a cart with a couple of guys and enjoying each other's company. And there was no, there's so much of the what you have to do in a golf outing that you don't have to do when you're just golfing. All you have to do is enjoy yourself. Enjoy the good shots. Stop worrying about the bad ones. And I think it's a lot like life, you know? We should be aspiring to that best tee shot and that best, you know, chip onto the green, because that's what we're capable of. The flubs and the miscasts and missing the ball and, you know, swinging into a tree. That's part of it, but, you know, I don't brag about that stuff. I aspire to that good shot and that good bit of, you know, good bit of sun, you know, and just being out.
You know, we had a conversation yesterday about what we're going to talk about on the show. And,
How'd that work out?
It was good, I thought. But the comment you made about, you know, I said, there's a little bit of civil unrest going on in this country. And, of course, it's because of, the elections are coming up. Mm-hmm. But, there was a lot of civil unrest in Ireland. But you said there was something that you could hope that maybe we could learn from that.
Well, anybody that was involved, like for three generations now, I'd say my grandfather came here in 1916 at the onset of the Easter Rising, which was actually when the Irish started to stand up to the British from centuries of oppression. And it's undeniable, you know, the great hunger, the starvation of the Irish people, and it brought most of them here. That's when Ireland started to shake off being subservient to another country. And it still has taken the psyche of the people to step away from a conflict footing. And for many years, there were six counties in the north from 1920 on that were still under British subjectry. And they treated, as they did so many other places in the world, sorry, friends of and Anglophiles, but they treated one group of people special and the other bunch of people bad. And so you had gerrymandering, And these are terms that we know here. You had discrimination in the workplace. Now, funny thing, anybody that was dropped in a helicopter couldn't tell the difference between the people. You know, they all looked pretty much the same. But what happened a few years ago, the Irish Americans realized that there was another life. They came here and they saw peace and they wanted to bring that prosperity and peace to Ireland. So some business people and some social activists went over and they met with both sides and they said, look, do you want to continue this? These are people that spend much of their life in jail or going to funerals. Do you want to see your next generation out of this? And the peace process began in 1990s, right? And yet still, there's divisions. The thing is this, those divisions are narrowing. And I saw the success of that, and I think a lot of the United States witnessed that. And we see the conflict getting closer right now because the issues are rising to the top. And when the issues rise to the top, the conflict gets heated up. But you know what? Our separation as Americans from each other is really color and race and all of these things. America has a good way of bringing all these things together if they address it and if they address it correctly. And I think that you're always going to have that hardline faction. It's fear of change that creates fear. And I think that we have to always consider the hope that what we're doing and that we're trying to accomplish and what other people are trying to accomplish is only to either bring them closer to us and what we've already achieved or to work together and make even a better, you know, future for everybody. So like you say, you can't take anything. You have to take the history into account, but you can't change that.
No.
And when you revise it, you jeopardize all of us. So I'm desperately against. That's why we have a library at the Hudson Valley Irish Center, because I don't want anybody to read revisionary Irish history or American history. I want them to read real history, because when you alter that, you endanger all of us. Mm-hmm. And that's.
And we have to learn from history.
Yeah.
Now, your wife did a little project during this pandemic. She helped out the restaurant workers.
Yeah, well, they saw that there were so many Irish people that maybe are, you know, working in the restaurants and the busboys and the bartenders. And obviously, everything shut down. Mm-hmm. So their initial intention, just like when we worked on immigration reform, was to help the Irish because we knew that community and they trust us. So Sláinte is to your health in Irish, and this was a health crisis. So they created Sláinte 2020, and they raised, I believe it was close to $600,000 from donations from regular people, and the organizations clubbed in a little bit. Every organization kicked in. So it was the sporting organization and the immigrant centers and the United Irish Counties, which is, they really united this time, and several other organizations and individuals. And they gave out real money at a time when people needed really good support. So, you know, it's gotten a lot of recognition. I don't think it's gotten enough, but it was a great project, you know.
Yeah. And then you did a project on your own.
Well, I mentioned Hurricane Sandy at the beginning of the show. Some of the people that worked together on Hurricane Sandy, a friend of mine, Brian, from across the river, he's a decorated detective, NYPD detective, called me up and said, we're going to get the band back together. Mm. And what we did was we went to all the closed-down construction companies and all the closed-down nail salons and all these places and said, can we borrow some of your PPE? I didn't even know what that stood for in the beginning, is for the hospital workers, the healthcare workers, the ambulance work. And you wouldn't believe the generosity of places that were shut down, not making any money, donating. Think about nail salons. I mean, you know, come on. You're scratching by in the nail salon, you know? I mean, they're not making a lot of money. But these people donated. And the Irish Mammies, it's an online community, they donated. And it was just so great to see. And we were giving it to real hospitals. These were not, this was not like what you would consider a place that doesn't have the wherewithal. But because the crisis was so universal, they couldn't get it shipped in fast enough. So we were able to bring PPE. And the other thing that we did was we brought some what I call Irish soul food. We went to a couple of restaurants that were able to function a little bit, you know, get their kitchens open. And we were able to make some food and deliver it to the healthcare workers. Because you know what the problem with food repetition is? I mean, Italians don't seem to have that problem, but the rest of us do.
We know how to mix it up.
Yeah, yeah. But food repetition is dangerous for your health. And so to bring in some shepherd's pie, which is a beautiful dish, mm-hmm. or fish and chips, which is a, you know, something that we all like to drink and eat the pub, you know, have the fish and chips. And that was a wonderful reception. Yeah, yeah. So you don't understand the tangible stuff of giving that PPE. That kind of goes in a door and it mm-hmm. disappears. But the smiles on the people's faces was worth it.
Well, I got to tell you, I did read up on Irish history, mm-hmm. and it was awesome. You know, I read about everything you just talked about, mm-hmm. and it was interesting. You know, and I think this time was a great opportunity. I mean, especially with these computers now, all you got to do is type something in, mm-hmm. and you could read about whatever you want, really.
Yeah.
And you know, it, for me, it was a chance to, you know, work on myself a little bit too, mm-hmm. you know, and not, you know, fear, like you said, is a big hindrance, but fear could also be a motivator, you know.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you have fear of paying your bills, you go to work and you pay your bills, you know. You got fear of, you know, being separated from your family, you call your family, you stay in contact, you know. I'm so lucky that, you know, I have 8 brothers and 1 sister, and we really get along pretty well, you know.
That's great.
And now there's like 35 nieces and nephews.
Wow.
And, you know, I call my nephew. He's in the Air Force Academy out mm-hmm. in Colorado. Mm-hmm. And he's doing great. It's his third year.
Great.
You know, he spent last semester home. He had to do it online. But then he was able to go this year. He helped out the recruits. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's very inspirational to see stuff like that.
Yeah, that's great.
But you got to be positive, mm-hmm. you know. Negativity is going to bring you down. And if you constantly think negative, you're going to be in a negative state. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. you know.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, a wise man said to me, don't try not to have anybody rent any space in your head.
That's right.
You know, so negativity is something that, like you say, is something that is present all the time. You know, I can't think of how many times you're involved with an organization, and there's the people there that are the naysayers, and it just seems that they're so obstreperous that that's all they want to do. But you know what? Out of that aggregation and aggravation, it keeps churn sometimes. So sometimes it's a positive effect, you know, because it keeps you moving. So, you know, we just, we have to keep striving
and always be positive.
And do good things, you know.
Dan, thanks for coming.
Well, it's a great pleasure.
I'm Victor Margiotta. This is The Community Show, and thank you for watching.